Hare Krishna Mataji, we couldn't hear you.
Hare Krishna? Yeah. Hare Krishna, Dandavats. I hope everyone can hear me. I got dropped off. Can everyone hear me?
Yes, Mataji. Yes, Mataji.
Okay. Thank you so much. Dandavats to everyone on the call. Thank you for joining the call, chanting so nicely. So today we are continuing with Valmiki Ramayana, and we are in Aranyakanda Part 4. It's actually a continuation from where we left last time. We'll start off with the prayers. ओम अज्ञानतिमिरांधस्य ज्ञानांजनाशलाकाय चक्षुरुन्मीलितं येन तस्मै श्री गुरवे नमः मुखं करोति वाचालं पंगुं लंगायते गिरिं यत्कृपातमहं वंदे श्रीगुरुं दीनतारिणं नमः ओं विष्णुपादाय कृष्णप्रेष्ठाय भूतले श्रीमते राधानाथस्वामी नित्यनामने नमः ओं विष्णुपादाय कृष्णप्रेष्ठाय भूतले श्रीमते भक्तिवेदांतस्वामी नित्यनामने नमस्ते सारस्वती देवे गौरवाणी प्रचारिणे निर्विशेष शून्यवादी पाश्चात्यदेशतारिणे जय श्री कृष्ण चैतन्य प्रभु नित्यानंद श्री अद्वैत गदाधारा श्रीवसादि गौर भक्तवृंद हरे कृष्ण 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 हरे 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 राम 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 हरे हरे विल डू प्रेयर्स टू वाल्मीकि हनुमान एंड लॉर्ड श्री रामचंद्र पूजन्तं रामरामेति मधुरं मधुराक्षरं आरुह्य कविताशाखां वन्दे वाल्मीकिकोकिलं वाल्मीके मुनिसिंहस्य कवितावनचारिणः शृण्वन् रामकथानाथं कोनयाति परां गतिं वेदवेद्ये परे पुंसे जाते दशरथात्मजे वेदप्राचेतसाधासेत् साक्षात् रामायणात्मना अञ्जनानन्दनं वीरं जानकीशोकनाशनं कपीशम् अक्षहन्तारं वन्दे लङ्काभयङ्करं मनोजवं मारुततुल्यवेगं जितेन्द्रियं बुद्धिमतं वरिष्ठं आत्मजं वानरयूदमुख्यं श्रीरामधूतं शिरसा नमामि आंजनेय मदिपाटनालनं कांचनाद्रि कमनीय विग्रहं पारिजाततरुमूलवासिनं भावयामि भवमाननंदनं यत्र यत्र रघुनाथ कीर्तनं तत्र तत्र कृतमस्तकांजलिं बाष्पवारि परिपूर्णलोचनं मारुतिं नमत राक्षसांतकं श्रीराघवं दशरथात्मजं अप्रमेयं सीतापतिं रघुकुलान्मय रत्नदीपं आजानुबाहुं अरविंद दयालदाक्षं रामं निशाचर विनाशकं नमामि हरे कृष्ण सो वी आर कंटिन्यूइंग विद आरण्यकांड नाउ इन द प्रीवियस सेशन वी सॉ हाउ मारीचा ही टुक द फॉर्म ऑफ अ गोल्डन डियर एंड सीता गॉट अट्रैक्टेड टू दिस डियर and Rama Lakshmana, both of them, they were diverted from the ashram. Ram killed Maricha, and hearing his cry in the guise of Rama's voice, Lakshmana was asked to go in search of Lord Ram inside the forest by Sita, and finally Ravana came there in the guise of a sannyasi and carried away Sita. So while Sita was being kidnapped in the Vimana of Ravan, in the airplane, from the airplane, she was shouting out to the trees, the Vanadevatas who are guarding the forests. She shouted out to Godavari River and she requested all of them to tell Lord Sri Ramachandra that she was being carried away by Ravana. And then she saw Jatayu. Jatayu was perching on top of a tree and his eyes were half closed. And when she saw Jatayu, she immediately identified him and she called out to Jatayu in a very beseeching voice. She was begging him. She asked him, "You're like my father-in-law. You're a well-wisher. And you're very old. I don't want you to combat with Ravana, who's a demon. And Ravana is equipped with all kinds of weapons. So I don't ask you to fight with Ravana. But rather, I please ask you to tell Ram that Sita is being kidnapped by Ravana." So we stopped here. with Sita spotting Jatayu and requesting Jatayu, please don't fight because you're very old, but please tell Ram when you see him that I've been carried away by this demon by the name Ravana. So this is what we saw in the previous class and we stopped here. Now we will continue from here. So when Jatayu, he heard the cries of Sita, he looked up and he was totally shocked actually to see Sita being abducted by Ravana. And that Jatayu, the huge bird with sharp beaks, these beaks were like, you know, as big as a mountain. He screamed out immediately identifying Ravana. He said, oh, ten-headed Ravana, how can you do such a deplorable deed? How can you carry away Ramchandra's wife? I am Jatayu. I am a follower of Dharma. And I am an eternal servant of Lord Ram. Ram is the master of the three worlds and Sita is his dear wife. How can you take her away? You boast yourself as being the king of a great province, golden place called as Lanka. Why are you behaving like this? Why are you laying your hands on other people's wives? Being a king, actually you're supposed to safeguard the people, and especially women are to be protected, not abducted. She is also the wife of another prince. That means she's like a mother, right? The wife of the king is like a mother. We know about the different matas. The queen becomes a mother. So she is also the wife of another prince. She's like a mother. Leave her. If you don't leave her now, a very big misfortune is going to befall you. So like this, Jatayu began to speak to Ravana. And Jatayu, when he was addressing Ravana, he was telling, hey Ravana, you're a descendant of Pulatsya. Now Pulatsya Maharishi is a great son who is a Manasaputra of Lord Brahma. Okay, he's a big Maharishi. How is he a descendant of Pulatsya? Because Ravana is the son of Vishravas, who was again the son of Pulatsya. And this Pulatsya was a brainchild of Brahma. So he's telling Ravana, you're all supposed to be very well-read scholars. You have a great lineage. You must be an expert in all these scriptures and all these spiritual sciences. And you should remember your scholarship. Whatever you're doing now, it is actually contradicting with your present behavior. Because the king is a leader. And he should set an example. Now, Ravana has a great lineage. He should be abiding by the laws of scriptures. He cannot touch another person's wife. Okay, leave that aside. Even otherwise, even if you're not, if you don't have such a great lineage, still you're a leader. You're a king. A king should set an example. So like this, Jatayu, it was like as if Jatayu is questioning Ravana, if someone of any one of your subjects from Lanka on following your present path of abducting Sita, if he tries to imitate you and if he takes away your wife Mandodari, will you tolerate it? You won't tolerate it, right? Like that only, you're not supposed to touch another person's wife. So like this, Jatayu began advising and arguing with Ravana and trying to tell him not to do this very bad act. So he was talking to Ravana like this. He says, has Lord Ram ever transgressed Lanka? Has he ever come to Lanka? Or has he ever attacked you? He's neither your friend nor your enemy. He's a neutral person. What right do you have to abduct his wife? What relation do you have with him? Why are you touching his wife? And then Jatayu says, see Ravana, I am 60,000 years old now. Actually, it appears that Ravana and Dashratha are of batchmates. Because both of them are friends and especially when Dasharatha died, we just heard recently that he was 60,000 years old. So Jatayu is also saying here in Ramayana, he's saying, I'm 60,000 years old. I'm an old man. I have no weapons in my hand. But still, look, Ravana, I'm not going to let you go away. Listen to my words and leave her. But still, in spite of me telling you so much, you still want to carry away. Remember, I am there. And I will fight with you until my death. Though I don't have any weapons, though you are young, you're a young, strong man, and I'm extremely old, still, I'm not going to leave Vaidehi with you. So Jatayu, he knew very well he's not going to win. He's saying all this, I'm old, I'm just after all a bird, and my weapons are just my beak and my claws, but still, I'm going to give you a fight until death. So in a very determined mind to somehow do his service to Lord Ram, Jatayu began to fight with Ravana after all this advice. Now, Ravana, he was very well equipped with all the weapons. He had a young, strong body, ten-headed, very, very capable. So he started shooting arrows at Jatayu. And Jatayu, with his huge wings, he was pushing away these arrows with his wings because that's the only weapon. That was his shield, right? His wings were his shield. So he was pushing away the weapons like that. And Jatayu fought with his claws and his beaks. He was trying to attack Ravana as much as possible. So in fighting with Ravana like this, Jatayu was hurt very severely by the arrows of Ravana. And he was almost about to collapse, but he just looked up and he saw Sita's miserable condition. He saw Sita there in a very helpless condition, weeping, and immediately Jatayu, he gathered the strength and he started shattering Ravana's bows and arrows and the chariots and everything. And then what Jatayu did was he attacked the mules that were pulling the chariot. You know, mules is somewhat neither a horse nor a donkey. It is like somewhat in between. So that is what Ravana had as his, in front of his chariot. He had golden mules, actually. It's described as ghost-faced golden mules. That's how Valmiki describes the mules. So Jatayu, he killed actually all the mules of the chariot, and he plucked off the head of the charioteer who was sitting in front of Ravana's chariot, in the front part of Ravana's chariot with his beak. So Jatayu broke the chariot. He somewhat damaged the chariot. He pulled off the charioteer's head with his beak, and then he destroyed the mules in front of the chariot. And then after doing this, Jatayu started attacking Ravana's body, and he started searing it severely with his wings. You know, he was scratching Ravana's body with his wings. So like this, Jatayu was slamming Ravana left and right, and when Ravana saw so much power from Jatayu, he got further angry. And he got so angry to the point that he took a huge sword and he severed the great eagle Jatayu's wings, his feet and his sides. So once his wings, his feet and all his side portion was completely severed by Ravana, Jatayu collapsed and he fell down. So when he fell down like this, he was almost about to lose his life, but still he was holding on. When Jatayu fell down like this, Sita, she was plunged into an ocean of misery when she saw her dear father-in-law like figure being harmed like this. So she reached out to Jatayu and she just embraced him just like she would embrace her own father. So like this she went and she embraced Jatayu. So like this Jatayu gave a good fight with Ravana, but he was rendered helpless after a huge combat. Now this character of Jatayu, he is not just celebrated for giving information to Ram at the time of his death. You know, we know that as we proceed further, we'll see that he was the one who gave information to Lord Ram. He's not just celebrated for that, but rather he's an example of a self-dedicated, selfless servant to his master. So in the previous chapters of this Aranyakanda, we saw how Jatayu, when he first met Ramachandra, he told Rama, "I will always be there to render any help to you. And I will protect Sita when you and Lakshmana go out of your residence." So he gave a word. He had promised Rama. So as promised, Jatayu kept up his pledge in helping Rama and protecting Sita. So he did it as much as he could without any hesitation. So that's why Jatayu celebrated as an epitome of selfless service. And the advice he gave to Ravana while Ravana was trying to abduct Sita, that is exemplary. Very, very beautiful advice and very beautiful arguments Jatayu gives. So Jatayu, he perfected Dasya Bhakti, that is devotion in the service, in the mood of a servant. He perfected that and he exhibited great devotion through selfless service, ready without any hesitation to give up his life for Lord Ram. So this is the kind of personality Jatayu was. Now, after Jatayu fell down with his wings chopped off, Ravana grabbed Sita and again took her inside and he began to fly inside the chariot. In his flying chariot, he began to go. Now, at that time, while they were traveling towards Lanka, Sita, she was so upset. She just saw how her dear father-in-law, like figure, Jatayu, gave up his life to protect her and how Ravana treated him. So Sita began to condemn Ravana. She was telling, "Ravana, are you a man? You're such a coward. You stole me away when my husband was away, and you boast saying that, oh, I'm Ravana. You know, you keep boasting about yourself saying that I never lose a battle, all this, you know, you talk about your great valor. But what nonsense. You are just taking away another man's wife in his absence without her consent and without winning her. Even in the animal world, if you see, there is a proper fight between two males to win a female. You might have seen in the bird family or in the deers. you will see during the mating season, there is a fight between the two males to win over a woman, okay, to win over a female deer or win over a female bird. So even there is, a proper fight or there is a proper method of acquisition. But what you are doing is simply taking away a woman without her interest. You know, she's not interested in you. She doesn't want to come with you. Neither have you won over her husband. You're not doing any of this and you're simply capturing her in the absence of her husband. So what kind of man are you? You're 100% covered. You're simply boasting about yourself. Not only that, you're harming Jatayu. He is such an old man and he's such a, he's supposed to be revered. Instead, you're harming him and you've almost killed him here. So like this, she condemns him and then she tells him, Ravana, you will see the Vaitarani River. Where is the Vaitarani River? It is in the hell. In the hellish planets, you have the Vaitarani River. Fifth canto of Bhagavatam has descriptions of all this. So she says, you will see the Vaitarani River in hell, and this river is actually filled with blood. So you will see that. You will also see sword-leaved forests in hell. It's called as Asipatra Vanam. That means sword-leaved forest. So it is a Naraka. What happens is, sinners are asked to go and hug a huge silk cotton tree like wooden structure with golden leaves and sapphire flowers and thorny and irony thorns. So what these will do is when the person is forced to embrace such a tree, the tree is so hot, it will be like burning hot, it will roast the body of the sinner. The person's body will get completely burnt in that high temperature. And not only that, these thorny leaves, they will be pinching and piercing the body of this person while it's getting roasted. So this is the kind of punishment that is given in hell for people who abduct, molest or rape another man's wife. So Sita is telling, you're sure to see Vaitarani, you're sure to get all this punishment because you've abducted another person's wife. So then Sita vowed, by whom? 14,000 demons. Who are these 14,000 demons? The demons sent by, who came with Karadushana. Remember, Rama had a fight with Karadushana and he did it single-handedly. So Sita is saying, by whom 14,000 demons were killed in war just within a few minutes? Single-handedly, without any help from his brother, that brave and mighty Raghava, Ramachandra, who is an expert in all missiles, will surely eliminate you. You have stolen his chosen wife. She says that and she curses him and she makes a vow there. You will be destroyed by him. So like this, after Sita spoke all these words, they were continuing to fly. And while they were flying like this towards south, towards Lanka, the Vimana was crossing the Kishkinta area. The Kishkinta, Pampa Sarovar. We are going to very soon go to that area after, as we move in the story. So the Vimana was crossing this area. And there on Rishyamukha Parvat, Sita, she spots five monkeys. So the verse goes like this. It says, Tesham Madhe Vishalakshi Kausheyam Kanaka Prabham Atariyam Vararoha Shubhani Abharanani Cha Mumocha Yadi Ramaya Samsheyuhu Iti Bhamini. She immediately, Sita immediately throws her ornaments and tears off a part of her upper garment, which is the, the pallu part of the section of the sari. She throws it onto a mountain where she sees five vanaras standing. And Sita was thinking, when she was throwing this garment and ornament, she was thinking, maybe these creatures, these ape-like creatures will be of some help to me. So like this, when Ravana was not noticing, when he was busy looking forward in the sky, Sita's telling, she takes out a part of her garment, she puts all the ornaments, some ornaments in that. Actually, it is described that the right portion of her ornaments, like one side of the ornaments she takes away, and she bundles them up, and she throws it on top of the Rishyamukha Parvat, when she spots these five vanaras standing and gazing at this airship. Actually, these five vanaras, they were kind of shocked. Oh, what is this? Is Ravana taking away such a beautiful woman, Like that they were asked, without blinking their eyes, with their mouth wide open, they were looking up at the airship. So when Sita saw this, she thought, yes, these people may help because they are looking at me with so much attention. Maybe if Ram crosses this area, they will tell Ram that actually a demon kidnapped your wife. So thinking like that, she tears off her upper garment, she puts all this and she throws it on that Rishyamukha Parvat. So like this, after she finished this, the airship again, it crossed over the Pampa River and then it reached the southernmost tip of India and it began to cross the mighty Indian Ocean. So it started crossing the Indian Ocean and finally it reached the golden city of Lanka. Lanka, very, 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 very beautiful place, full of gold. So when they reached Lanka, Lanka looked so beautiful, very well symmetrized roadways, very beautiful structures. It had lovely archways and Sita, he entered this beautiful city of Lanka and he finally reached his palace. So when he reached the palace along with Sita, he got down in his palace and he took Sita through many golden doors, gem-studded staircases, marble floors, and all the chambers inside the palace, they were thronging with many crowds. So many people were there in the palace. So like this, in his beautiful palace, he took Sita and he chose a particular chamber where he wanted to keep Sita and he put her inside that chamber and he asked her to stay there. Then he called all the maid servants, all the demonesses who were there to serve him. He called all the maid services and told them, take very good care of this woman. I've brought her. Provide her with all the ornaments and garments. Make sure that she looks very beautiful. Make sure that she's happy and her stay is very opulent. Like that, he gives instructions to all the demonesses and he asks all of them to take proper care of her. Then he goes to his court where all his followers are waiting for him. And he calls out 8 powerful demons and he tells them, you 8 people, you 8 are very, very powerful. Now I order you 8 of you, go back to Janasthan. Janasthan is the place where Karadoshana was there, right? It was vacated because of Ramachandra. Ramachandra killed all the 14,000 demons. So now Ravana says, you 8 of you, you're the best, okay? So you go to Janasthan and occupy that place and continue living there. And if at all that Ramachandra again comes back, you immediately send me a report. I will handle him. So like this, Ravana gives instructions to some of his demons to go back and occupy Janasthan. Now, Ravana, after giving all these instructions to his assembly of members, he comes back to the room where Sita was there. So he comes back and he begins to coax her somehow or the other. You know, he was trying hard to convince her, somehow please marry me. You become the queen. You become the leader of all my queens. I have so many queens, but you know what? You can become the leader of all of them. So he began to show off his opulence of Lanka because this is the first time Sita has seen Lanka, right? So he's telling her, look at my Lanka. It is so beautiful. It's full of gold and it's so gorgeous. And this whole palace will be yours if you become my wife. And all these millions of demons who are serving me, all of them will become your servants. So like this, he began to boast about himself and he was showing off his opulence and telling Sita, look, I have a great offer for you. Just become my wife and you can enjoy all of this. So he began to speak to Sita like that. And Sita, she calmly heard him out and then she picked a straw, a blade of grass that was sticking to a sari. She just picked it up and she kept it in front of Ravana, indicating that you are more insignificant than the straw for me. And that blade of grass actually even serves as a screen between her and Ravana. She's speaking to another man who's not her husband, right? So she puts a straw in front of him and she begins to speak. For every sentence Ravana spoke, Sita gives back answers very boldly to Ravana. For every sentence he spoke. And she clearly in those answers, she very clearly tells him that her loyalty to Rama will not allow anyone else to touch her. Nobody can touch her other than Ram. So when she spoke like that very boldly, Ravana got very furious and he said, you're speaking back angry words to me. So listen to my words. For a period of 12 months, I will give you time. I will give you only 12 months time. And this, and you beautiful lady who is giving me these charming looks and smile, if you don't come under my control within that 12-month period, then my cooks will slice you into pieces and prepare a morning meal for me from your flesh. So this is how he scares Sita. He says, I'll give you only 12 months time. within 12 months, you have to come under my control. You should satisfy my desires. If you don't do that, at the end of 12 months, if you behave very badly, I will cut you into pieces and I will make a morning meal for me. Rakshasas, they eat very good raw flesh also. So he said, they will cook a very good grand meal for me with your flesh and I will eat you up if you don't come under my control. Now, what is this 12-month period is actually commentated on many scholars. They say that if a king conquers another man and seizes his queen, a 12-month time is given to the defeated king to regain his captivated queens by making another round of combat. Okay, so basically, within 12 months, if the defeated king or the person whose wife has been stolen doesn't come back, then only a 12-month period is given to him. If he doesn't come back, then the wife stolen wife becomes the property of the person who has abducted her. Okay, so this is what the rule says. If the defeated king is unable to do so or reluctant to do so, the captivated queens of the defeated king automatically belong to the conquering king after 12 months. This is Rajaniti Shastra, Shanti Parva, Mahabharata. Mahabharata, Shanti Parva, this rule is discussed. So that's why he is giving her 12-month period. And this is some commentaries on why it is 12 months. Okay. So then he calls out, Ravana, he calls out to all his demoniac female assistants and he tells them, oh demonesses, let this Maithili be taken to the center of Ashoka Gardens. Because she refuses. She says, you know, I'm not going to satisfy you. I'm not going to become your queen. So now Ravana has decided to give her 12 months and he tells these demonesses who are guarding her to take her to Ashoka Gardens. And there you put her in the garden, no more chamber, no more palace for her. Put her in the Ashoka Gardens. And what you need to do is you should guard her very carefully, observe all her moves. And you should threaten her every day with your words and again speak my glories and somehow change her mind, brainwash her and bring her under your control and then give her to me. So like this, he gives specific instructions to all the demonesses who are guarding Sita and asks them to take Sita immediately to Ashokavan. So when Ravana ordered all these demonesses, they all took Maithili to Ashoka Garden. And Ashoka Garden is actually very, very beautiful. It is described so beautifully in Valmiki Ramayana. It was beautiful. It was surrounded with lots of trees that yielded fruits all time the year. And there was a diverse variety of flowers. And the whole scenario, I mean, wherever the entire garden, it was filled with all kinds of lusty birds, you know. So Ravana wanted her to go there and have the right mood so that her mind changes. So he sends her to Ashokavan along with these demoness who are every day talking to her and telling her, if you don't listen to Ravana, I will torture you. Ravana's glory is this, that, like that, you know. So people were brainwashing her every day and putting her in a very beautiful scenario. So this is what was the Ravana's idea. So this happened in Lanka. Now Sita has gone to Ashokavan. She's guarded by all the demonesses, okay. So now we have to do scene change because we are continuously saying what is happening to Sita, but we forgot what happened to Lord Ram. So Lord Ram, remember, in the previous class, he stopped at where? He went in search of Maricha. He killed Maricha and Maricha screamed and he died. He left his body and he merged into Lord Ram. A spark came out. It merged into Lord Ram. All this we saw. Now Lord Ramachandra, he began to run back towards the cottage. Remember when we were seeing last class, we were telling that Rama immediately thought, oh my God, this Maricha has screamed out in my voice. So that means Lakshmana and Sita will get worried now. And I don't know what will happen to them. They may come running into the forest. So thinking like that, Rama began to rush back to the cottage. And we stopped there. And then we started seeing Ravana's story. So now we have to go back to what happened to Lord Ramachandra in the forest. So we will go there. So, when Rama thought something might have happened to Vaidehi, he began to run towards the cottage. And when he was running, he started seeing bad omens. I was again mentioning this during Balakanda also, that these bad omens, judging bad omens, seeing the movements of animals and birds will be there throughout Valmiki Ramayana. Not only animals and birds, even bodily indications. It will be there throughout Ramana. Every Kanda you will find this. Everywhere you will see how to judge bad omens. So Rama, he started running back. And that time he was hearing jackals howling. So immediately he thought, oh my God, this is a bad omen. I'm really worried of Vaidehi, he will be safe. So, and he was also thinking, this Maricha, he's yelled out in my voice, mimicking my voice. So if Lakshmana listens to this voice, recognizing my voice, he will instantly start running towards the forest. Or if Maithili listens to it, she will hasten Lakshmana to come here. And all this is going to happen. He started feeling all these, he started getting all these feelings because of the bad omens that he was seeing. He was seeing that animals and birds were moving in circumambulations from left side to right side. Usually it will be right, like you do circumambulate in one particular clockwise direction. Rather, he was seeing them anti-clockwise direction. Animals and birds were going in anti-clockwise direction. And these animals and birds were shrieking and they were making loud noises. Jackals were howling. So seeing all this, Rama felt something very bad has happened and he rushes towards the hermitage. So while he was rushing towards the hermitage, at that time, he spots Lakshmana who's running towards him. So when he sees Lakshmana, Rama is like, oh my God, Lakshmana, you are here. Why did you come here leaving Sita? Ram said, I'm seeing all these bad omens. And why did you leave her? Will she ever be safe? Why, who asked you to leave her? The deer that I killed actually was a demon. It was Maricha, as you had already mentioned, because Lakshmana was the one who told this was Maricha. He said, as you said, it was Maricha. And now my left eye is twitching and my left shoulder is twitching. Jackals are howling. Will Maithili be safe? Like this, he began to call out to Lakshmana. I hope no one has harmed her. You know, he was in total distress. He says, Lakshmana, I'm really worried. Why should you come to the forest by leaving her behind? So Rama tells Lakshmana, see Lakshmana, if I don't see Sita at the entrance of the ashram, I will really stop breathing. I cannot take this if I'm separated from Sita. If Sita is not there in the ashram, something has happened to her, I will really die, he says like that. Ram says this, just imagine, he says that to Lakshmana. And then, Rama and Lakshmana immediately, they hold hands and they run towards the cottage. And there, when they go near the entrance of the cottage, they don't find Sita. So they run into the cottage, Rama runs inside, he looks into every nook and corner of the cottage, he doesn't find her. Then he rushes out. He goes to a place of the pastime of Sita, Sita usually spends time there. She goes running there and he says, oh, this is the place where she used to move. She used to go and pluck flowers here, but I don't find her here. And then again he runs into the hermitage and he sees an empty cottage. Then again he rushes out to another place where Sita used to play. So he goes and says, oh, this is the place where she used to play with the deer and the squirrels and the birds. Oh my God, she's not here. Again, he runs inside the cottage and again he sees a vacant hermitage. Again, he runs out and he goes out to a place where she used to offer prayers and he goes out and he searches there. This is the place Sita used to offer prayers and she's not here. Again, he screams and he runs into the cottage. He runs outside the cottage. He goes into a state that is unexplainable. He just loses it. And then he sits down plunged into an ocean of deep despair as this cottage was empty of Sita and the surrounding areas where Sita used to spend time is now empty. She's not to be found anywhere. Then Rama, in deep frustration, he begins to chastise Lakshmana. He says, Lakshmana, who asked you to come out without Sita? And then Lakshmana explains the whole thing that had happened. He tells her, because we heard your voice, Sita forced me to come. My dear brother, she forced me. Not only that, she made harsh remarks on me, saying that I am having an eye on her. I am desiring to have her. So I didn't have a choice. I had to leave because she had spoken like that. And Rama told Lakshmana, whatever she might have spoken, you shouldn't have come this far into the forest. I understand your point, but still you shouldn't have come this far leaving her. It is not the right thing to do in a forest where so many demons are there. She's a woman. You can't leave her like that. And then Rama begins to cry and cry and he's lamenting for Sita's separation. So he begins to search for her. He goes on asking very pitiably each and every plant and tree and animal in a frenzied attitude. He was going to every plant asking, did you see Sita? Did you see Sita? Did you see Sita? He goes and asks everybody. And then he becomes extremely dejected. And then Lakshmana begins to calm him and he advises him, see Rama, we have to search. He tells his brother, we have to search. She will be available somewhere. We will go find her. Then later they go through the entire forest in that area. They go through the mountains and the lake sides, but everywhere Sita remains unseen. Now Rama, he was weeping and he was intensely searching for Sita. So the way it is described in the Ramayana, it is not like some mundane kind of a hero searching for his lover. Rather, this is the mood of Vipralamba or Viraha Bhav. And this emotion needs no introduction to us as we are already reading Chaitanya Charitamrita. And in Chaitanya Charitamrita, you can say that it is almost a treatise on the subject matter. Also, we have read the gopis' emotions of love and separation in the Srimad Bhagavatam. We have also heard how Lord Krishna used to weep and wail in separation from the residents of Vrindavan in the Brihad Bhagavatamrita. So we have an idea, though we don't understand it completely. Of course, we don't understand it completely. But still, there is a hint, there is an idea of this love and separation. What happens to the person in love and separation? So that is depicted so beautifully in all of our scriptures. And Lord Ramachandra, he goes through this viraha at this period in time and he is in a total state of despair and he is totally frenzied. He is going and talking to the leaves and the bushes, like how we see the gopis of Vrindavan. So like that, Ramachandra is going through this emotion. So in this mood of separation, he was crying out to Sita. And Lakshmana, at this time, he is very calm and he is trying to console Rama, saying, "See, my dear brother, somehow or the other we will get Sita back." And, you know, Rama has almost lost it. He's saying, "I'm so distressed. Actually, Lakshmana, I think it's high time you go back to Ayodhya and I will die in this forest without Sita." And then when he says all this, Lakshmana is like very surprised because now Rama is talking like this. Lakshmana consoles him, he encourages him, and he tells, "We will find Sita. Come, let's go search here, let's go search there." Like that, he encourages Ram, and he takes Ram along with him, and they continue to search. So like this, while they continue to search and search, and Ram tells Lakshman, "You know what, Lakshman, go and search near the river Godavari. There is a good chance that Sita might have gone to pick lotuses there." So he says this to Lakshmana. And Lakshmana says, "Yes, that's a very good idea. Let's go and search near the banks of river Godavari." So Lakshman starts running towards Godavari. And see, Ramachandra also begins to run behind Lakshmana. They go towards river Godavari. And when they go near Godavari, they shout out to river Godavari. Ramachandra shouts out, "Did you see Sita? Sita, Sita, where are you? Godavari Mata, please tell me where is Sita." So he calls out to Godavari. But at that time, Godavari remains speechless. This is an important part in Ramayana. Godavari did not answer Lord Ramachandra. Now one may ask, how can a river answer? Yes, a river can answer. Because a river meanders, you know, it moves. So the river could have moved in the southern direction where Ravana had went along with Sita. She could have done it, but she did not. She chose to remain silent. Why? Because she was scared. She was scared of Ravana. She was scared if she informed Ram about Vaidehi or about what evil-minded Ravana did. She was scared that Ravana, with all his mystic powers, he will completely dry her up. So she remained silent and she failed in her service to Lord Ram. She failed in her service to Lord Ram. Now, Rama, he told Lakshmana, "Look at this Godavari. She's remaining silent and she's not telling me anything. What will I go and tell Janaka Maharaj? What will I tell her mother-in-law, Kausalya Devi?" That is his own mother. He's telling, "What will I tell her when I go back to Ayodhya? What will I tell? Will I tell I lost my wife? What is this? Godavari is remaining silent." Then Lord Ram, he went to the animals in that area and he asked them, "Where is Vaidehi?" And all the animals, what they did was, they were very smart. They didn't let down Ram. What they did was, they turned southwards, looked up in the sky, and started running southwards. Okay? So they were running in the direction in which Maithili was taken away. So they ran into the southern direction. They took a few steps. They stopped. They looked back at Ram. Again they ran. They stopped. They looked back at Lord Ram. They did all this. The animals did all this. So at that time, Lakshmana seems to be an expert in body language of animals. Because when he saw Maricha also, he was the first one who identified, there is no golden deer. Yeah, I know all the 8,004,000 species. This is not a regular deer. This is definitely Maricha. He gave he had 100% clarity on animals. So Lakshmana, seeing this body language of animals, expertly he could identify what these animals are trying to tell. So he told Ram, brother, these animals are indicating that if we move southwards, somehow or the other we can trace on the path where Sita has gone, and there is a good chance that we can even find her somewhere down south. Okay? So like this, he tells Ramchandra, and both the brothers, they began to walk in the southern direction. And carefully, while they were walking in the southern direction, they were examining the ground to see if there are any impressions of Sita. And like this, they were searching if there are any marks of Sita that they could find. So like this, when they were walking in the southern direction, in one place, they saw flowers fallen down from a person, and it was strewn and scattered all over the place. So immediately, Rama, he could recognize. He said, "Hey, Lakshmana, these are the flowers that I had given to Vaidehi when she was in the forest, and she very carefully put this on her bun. She tucked it into her bun. So these flowers have fallen from her. And look at these flowers, they are unwithered by the sun. You know, they are safeguarded by the sun. And they are not swept away by the air. So that means the earth, the sun and wind are actually favoring us. Because actually I forgot to mention in the previous time, the previous scene when Rama was asking everyone if the, I just said for plants and I said, he was asking the trees and he was asking animals. Actually, Rama was even asking the sun, because the sun is a witness, right? Like we read in the Bhagavatam also that the different witnesses, I think it comes in Ajamila story, about the different witnesses who are watching us all the time. So the sun is also, the sun and the air are also witnesses for all our deeds. Not only the Paramatma, even they are our witnesses. So he asks the sun and the wind, to tell where Vaidehi is, and the sun and the wind have replied like this. So nice. The sun has not withered the flowers that Vaidehi had worn, and it is now strewn on the ground. And the wind has not carried it and scattered it somewhere else. It's all remaining there. So that means immediately Ram said, "See, the sun, the wind, and the earth, they are giving a helping hand to me." Then Ram looks at the mountains and he asks, "Have you seen this a beautiful limbed woman in these woodlands?" Like that, he asks the mountain. And the mountain, what it did was, it echoes the words of Lord Ram without giving a clear answer. So Ram gets very angry and he says, "I will shatter this mountain and burn it. I will dry up this Godavari river. Both of them are not giving me answers properly because both of them are fearing Ravana." So nice. The mountain and Godavari, they are not giving answers. They don't give clear answers. So Ramchandra says like this, both of them have fear to Ravana, hence they are not giving me proper answers. And then he cried out and cried out, and suddenly his eyes fell on the ground as they walked further, and he saw gigantic footprints of the demon. And these footprints were heavily sunken, that is, they were heavily gone inside the soil. And he also saw the footprints of Vaidehi, his wife, and it appeared that she was running here and there, the footprints. And then he called out to Lakshmana and he said, "Lakshmana, Lakshmana, see here, there are huge footprints of a demon, and I also see footprints of my wife. Vaidehi's footprints are also here. And not only that, in a few feet away, I'm able to see blood drops. And these blood drops look like golden droplets that has been dropping off from a person. Oh my God, Lakshmana, has someone ripped her and devoured her? Has a demon ripped her apart?" And then he runs a little more further and he sees a shattered shield. He sees bows and arrows, and he sees chariot parts. And also he sees a dead charioteer whose head was ripped off. Now Rama is like totally confused. He's like, "Whose charioteer is he?" Now I think Rama is thinking in his mind, what could have happened? He's seeing blood drops. He's seeing Vaidehi's footprints here and there. And he's seeing demoniac footprints. He's seeing parts of a chariot. And he's seeing armor. And he's seeing weapons. I mean, like, you know, arrows and all that. He's totally confused. So he says, "What has happened here? Maybe two demons have fought over Vaidehi, and one demon has, been successful over the other, and the other demon has ripped Vaidehi apart." So like that, he continues to think in his mind, what is it that could have happened? Actually, all this is the result of Jatayu's fight. Remember when Jatayu was fighting, the arrows were strewn around, and he destroyed the chariot and all that. When we spoke, he pecked off the head of the charioteer. Actually, he's seeing that scene now. He's seeing that part of the area now where this fight had happened. So Ram says, something very, very, very severe has happened and I cannot really live anymore. You know what, Lakshmana, I can live without all my relatives, but Sita is my greatest strength. I cannot live without her. He says like that. And then he gets very angry. He's upset. He's angry. So many emotions in Lord Ram. He grabs out his bow and arrow and he vows, if I don't take back my wife Sita from that demon, I will destroy this entire universe. So saying like this, Ram goes to a state where he aims his arrow to destroy the entire universe. When he starts doing like this, Lakshmana immediately jumps up. With folded hands, he says, my dear brother, this is so unlikely you. Please calm down. Don't jump into conclusions. We will surely find Sita. I strongly believe nothing has happened to Sita. No one can do anything to her. We will search in every nook and corner, every corner of the lake and the forest and the caves and towns. We will even go to the abodes of the demigods. We will somehow find Sita. Like this, he tells Ram, my dear brother, don't consider annihilating this entire universe because of the misdeed of one person towards Sita. One person has behaved badly towards Sita. That is evident. I understand. But it doesn't mean you can destroy the entire universe. I am telling you, nothing has happened to her. Please count on your own valor. You are Ram. You're so valorous. You think you cannot find out Sita? Somehow or the other, together we will go. We will go everywhere and we will find Sita. So like this, Lakshmana, he behaves in a very matured manner, Lakshmana. Usually it is seen that Lakshmana is the one who gets very angry at everything and he just impetuously, he just goes, you know, doing things. But here you see Lakshmana is very matured when his dear brother is agitated. So he advises Lord Ram, please calm down. So at that time, listening to the good advice of his younger brother, Ramchandra, he agrees to whatever Lakshmana says, and they proceed further. And as they proceed further, suddenly Ram spots Jatayu. Now Jatayu, Now Jatayu was fallen on the ground and his wings were chopped off, we saw, right? So Jatayu was buckling on the ground and he was totally blood-stained. His entire body was covered with blood. So when Rama, from a distance, he sees Jatayu, he just sees him as a huge being. He thinks that that huge bird is a demon in disguise. That means a demon has taken the form of a big bird and he's devoured Sita. He's eaten up Sita. That's what he thinks when he sees Jatayu from a distance. And he runs towards Jatayu, thinking that Jatayu is a demon. He, with an arrow, you know, strung to his bow, he aims at the bird and he gets close. So when he comes close to Jatayu, immediately Jatayu identifies Rama, who's his friend Dasharath's son, and he cries out to him in a very pitiable tone, with blood oozing out from his body. He says, Rama, you're here. Please don't shoot that arrow. It's me, Jatayu. Can you identify me? It's Jatayu. The Ravana carried away Sita. He has left me in this dying condition. Oh, Rama, he stole away Sita when you and Lakshmana were away and I tried to stop him. I fought with him. I attacked his chariot and the charioteer. I killed the charioteer. I killed these mules. So he's showing everything to Lord Ramachandra. And then, see the charioteer. Do you see him at a distance? That charioteer was killed by me with my wings. So like this, he tells how he tried to, stop Ravana from taking away Vaidehi. And Ravana chopped off his wings. And Ravana flew skyward, taking Sita with him in the southern direction. So when Rama heard all this and he saw that it was Jatayu being hurt so severely, Rama fell down to the ground and he lovingly embraced Jatayu and he said, it is my great misfortune. Actually, it's my mistake, Jatayu. It's my misfortune that everything like this has happened, that I came to the forest, my wife was stolen, and now you are being in this condition. Whatever has happened to you is all because of me, dear Jatayu. He says like that and he embraces Jatayu and he cried again and again. And he begins to inquire from Jatayu what actually transpired. At that time, Jatayu told him about how this demon by the name Ravana kidnapped Sita and Jatayu was trying to save her, but still Jatayu was hurt by Ravana's death blows and Ravana flew away in the southern direction. Then Jatayu said a very important statement, which I will read. He says, Yena yati muhurtena sitam adaya ravanaha vipranashtam dhanam kshipram tat swami pratipadyate vindo nama muhurto asau searcha kakutsa na abudat. That means, in which muhurtam or which part of the time Ravana has taken away Sita, that muhurta is called as Vinda. If any riches are lost during that time, the original possessor of those riches will repossess them very quickly. O Kakutsa. Kakutsa is Lord Ram because he is a descendant of the Kakutsa dynasty. So he says, O Kakutsa, he, that Ravana, is unmindful of that fact and he told Sita, but he will eventually lose her. So beautiful. Jatayu is saying that when Ravana kidnapped Sita, it was during this particular spell of the day. Like a day is divided into many muhurtas. Okay, this muhurta called as the Vinda muhurta comes during the 11th portion of a day. A day is divided into different sections and the 11th portion is called as the Vinda. It's also sometimes called as Vijaya Muhurta. So during that time, when something is taken away from a person, the stolen riches will go back and reach to that person, the original possessor, for sure, if something is taken back during this time. So that's why he says that actually this Ravana has taken away Sita during this Muhurta. That means Sita will come back to you for sure. Take my words. Jatayu very confidently says. Now, yeah, I was explaining about the 11th spell of the day, which is called as Vindam. Now, why, and Jatayu, he also in his statement, he says that Ravana, unmindful of this fact, stole away Sita. Why does he say that Ravana, unmindful of this fact? Because actually Ravana was a great astrologer. He was a very well-read scholar, as we all know. Not only that, he was also a very great astrologer. He knew all these muhurtas and timings and everything. He was an expert, Ravana. But still, he didn't care for all that. He was so overwhelmed, I mean, so overtaken, or what do you call that? He was completely loaded with lust that he just wanted her. He didn't care for these things. He is actually the author of Ravana Samhita, which is actually one of it's a very intellectual astrological work, actually. He's given so many details. Ravana Samhita is one of the very famous astrological works. He's such a famous astrologer, Ravana, but still he didn't care for this. And Jatayu is pointing it out. See, that guy didn't even care for it. He just picked away Sita and went away. So be assured, Rama, Sita will come back to you. So then Jatayu, he continues to say that on stealing your wife Janaki, the chief of demons Ravana, he will ruin himself, just as how a fish swallows a baited fish hook. That Ravana who stole your wife, the son of Vishravas and the half-brother of Kubera, will kill himself. Because he is just like how you capture a fish using a bait and the fish comes to eat it and you can capture the fish like that, you will capture Ravana, he says to Rama. So after he said all this, Jatayu's lifer left his body while his eyes were completely fixed on the beautiful form of Lord Ramchandra. Now Rama was in great anguish and he felt very severe pain, more than what he felt when Sita was missing actually. Because his pain was augmenting, it was reaching a point where he couldn't take it anymore. Like that, he was in so much pain. His pain was augmenting more and more and more. As it is, he has lost his life now, Jatayu. So like that, Rama was very, very anguished. And then Rama told, O Saumitri, my dear Lakshmana, get firewood. I will produce fire by the friction of these two sticks. And I, with my own hand, will cremate this bird who died because of me. So actually, Rama, he performed the final rites of Jatayu, just like how a son would do for his loving father. So Ramchandra, he did the final rites and he declared. Ramchandra is the Supreme Lord. He never showed much of that. He never indicated to the world openly that I am the Supreme Lord. He didn't do that much. But here, in this particular pastime of Jatayu, Ramchandra declares this eagle will reach the highest destination and go back to the spiritual world, Vaikuntha. He declares that being the lord of Vaikuntha or being the lord of the spiritual world. So he tells Jatayu, and Jatayu was liberated and he went back to Vaikuntha. And Lord Ramachandra, he performed his loving service. Jatayu, he performed his loving service to Lord Ramachandra. Now, if you look at it, Jatayu as such didn't have any major qualifications to be liberated. See, if you see the body of Jatayu, Jatayu was a scavenger. A vulture actually eats dead things. It doesn't even hunt. Hunt you cannot say, it will eat. But dead and fallen, decaying matter, it will go and eat. That is what a vulture actually does. So this, he had the body of a vulture. Not a very great qualification. Okay, he's not in a Brahmana body, or he's not in a person who's been following regulative principles or something like that. He never did any, Shastric study, like he did a Bhakti Shastric course or whatever. He was not a learned man. He was not performing 24-hour Shravanam Kirtanam, nothing like that. He was an eagle, 60,000 years old eagle or vulture who was eating dead matter. And he was not performing these activities of Bhakti full-time. He was also an agrahatya. Agrahatya means one who's killed by a brahmana. Now, a person who kills a brahmana, he gets a dosh or a dosham, or what you say, or he gets a blemish that is called as brahmahati dosha. Okay, that means you should not kill a brahmana. It is considered as one of the greatest sins. Killing a brahmana is considered very, very bad. Not only that, being killed by a brahmana is also considered very bad, and that person is disqualified from liberation. Why? Because a brahmana is considered to be such a sattvic and a pure person that if a person is being killed by a brahmana, how bad he should be. So that is the logic in shastras. And the name of such a person who is being killed by a brahmana is called agrahatya. So Jatayu is agrahatya, but of course Ravana is no great Brahmin. That's a different story altogether. But if you just go by rules, still Ravana is a Brahmin, okay, because he is a Brahmin descendant. Now this Jatayu, he was killed by Ravana, so he becomes an agrahatya. So many disqualifications for Jatayu, if you just look at it. But still, Jatayu, he had the causeless mercy of the Lord, and he gave his life completely, selfless offering to the Lord, and he didn't care for his life. He just gave it up as a service, complete surrender to the Lord. So like this, in spite of so many disqualifications, not a great birth, not a great body, all these things, all these are overruled by the Lord. Then there is pure devotion and you're able to give up yourself completely to the Lord. The Lord's mercy dawns on you. So all these rules no more interfere. So this is the qualification of Jatayu, why he was liberated. Now after performing Jatayu's final rites, Rama and Lakshmana, they proceeded inside the forest and they started to proceed in the southern direction, but specifically southwestern direction, Ramayana says. They were asked to go in the southwestern direction. And they went to a thick, as they moved, they went inside a very thick, dense forest. And this forest was very, very horrible, actually. It was very smelly and it was very thick and it was very horrible. And there, a huge demoness by the name Ayomukhi was living. So there's a very short story of Ayomukhi. Valmiki finishes it off very fast. He says, there was a demoness by the name Ayomukhi. She looked very scary and huge. And she lived in this forest, and when she first spotted Lakshmana, because Lakshmana was moving ahead of Ram, when she spotted Lakshmana who was walking ahead, she fell in love with Lakshmana and she went running to him and she embraced him and she told him, "Oh dear handsome, you look so good and I am Ayomukhi. I've accepted you as my lover. So please come, let's pour together in the forest. Please satisfy my desires." So like that she calls out to Lakshmana. So as it is, Lakshmana is now very, very angry. He's very irritated. Already Sita is missing. He's very desperate to find Sita. Ramchandra is in this condition. So when she came and she approached Lakshmana like this, Lakshmana got very angry. And as usual, he took his sword and he severed off her nose and ears. Standard, Lakshmana standard. Any demoness who comes to him, nose and ears are gone. He took it out and then the demoness shrieked and she ran away. So this episode over. Next, again, Lakshmana started seeing bad omens in his, again, further bad omens Lakshmana was feeling. So his left shoulder was twitching, his eyes, left eyes were twitching. So immediately he told Rama, I have a very strong feeling another demon is, another demon or demoness is going to come, another demon will surely come. So at that time, they see a huge earth-shattering noise inside the forest, and a demon by the name Kabanda appeared. Now, this demon has a very important role, okay? I will try to finish it fast because we just have a few minutes left, 3-4 minutes, so I'll try to go faster, as fast as possible. Now, this demon had a very terrible appearance. He was headless. Actually, there was nothing above his shoulders. He didn't have a neck. He didn't have eyes or face like that. He was headless demon with very long arms. And interestingly, his eyes were situated in his stomach area. In his paunch, his eyes were situated. The tongue was in his forehead and the forehead was on his chest. You have to imagine this now. It's just a torso, no head, and the tongue is on the forehead. And where is the forehead? It is not in the face area. Forehead is on the chest area. And then eyes was in the belly area. So this demon with very long arms, he starts coming towards Rama Lakshmana, outstretching his overlong arms. Okay. He comes like this in the forest. Now, Lakshmana and Rama, they spot this demon. And this demon's name is Kabanda. Now, Kabanda, when he saw both the Raghavas, both Rama Lakshmana, he stretched out his arms and he took them in his palms. Kabanda captured both Rama and Lakshmana and he began to squeeze them with his fists. So he was squeezing them with all the might. So at that time, Lakshmana, when he got into the hands of this demon, he felt helpless now. Now this is Lakshmana's turn to feel helpless. He started feeling helpless and powerless and he told Ram, oh Ram, you somehow escape and find Vaidehi, I'm going to give up my life here. I'm not able to tolerate the squeezes of this demon. Looks like I'm going to die right here. So I'll give up my life here. You please find Sita, somehow go back to Ayodhya, rule Ayodhya. And don't forget me. He says like that and he's saying, I'm going to die now. At this time, it's Rama's turn to turn courageous because, you know, they always compliment each other, Rama and Lakshmana. When Lakshmana's down, Rama uplifts him and Rama's down, Lakshmana's uplifting him. Very nice brother pair. So Rama says, you know, at this time, he gave us all his courage and he says with all determination, my dear brother, Lakshmana, you don't speak like this. What are you talking? Nothing will happen to you. So at that time, the demon is like, what is this? These two brothers are talking to each other. And he looks at both of them and he's asking, who are you both? Why have you come to this forest? What are you doing here? Both of your, arms look like, you know, bull humps. You're so well-built, both of you are. You are holding long bows and arrows and swords. What are you doing in this forest? Then Kabanda was growling at them because they both are talking nonstop. And Kabanda is like, what are you both doing here in my arms? So he started growling at them and he was scaring them. And then he said, I will devour both of you. Who are you two? At that time, Rama and Lakshmana, after Rama's very inspiring speech to Lakshmana, Rama and Lakshmana, they cut off the arms of the demon with their swords. And then the demon's hands got severed. You know, it just fell down. And blood was flowing out from both his shoulders and he was in extreme pain. And then with a piteous voice, the demon asked, who are both of you? Why are you here? How come you're able to sever off my arms? Who are you? At that time, Lakshmana answered, he is known to the people by the name Ram. He is the descendant of the Ikshvaku dynasty. And you know me as his younger brother, Lakshmana. That is my name. We both came to this forest due to our stepmother. And another demon captured my brother's wife, so we are in search of her. Like that, he introduces himself. He says, this is Rama. He is the descendant of the Kakatiya dynasty. We both are brothers, and my name is Lakshmana. He introduces himself. Then he asks the demon, but who are you? Your legs are somewhat broken. Your mouth is on your chest, and you are topless. And your eyes are somewhere. Your tongue is somewhere. Why are you like this, and what are you doing in this forest? So at that time, when Lakshmana asks the demon, Kabanda, he's very happy. Actually, his whole demeanor changes. He becomes very happy. And he's very delighted when Lakshmana gave his introduction and Rama's introduction. The words of Indra came to the memory of Kabanda. He said to Ram and Lakshman, earlier, I had a very beautiful and strong body. I was famous in all the three worlds as the handsome son of Dhanu. once disguising myself in this kind of a horrendous form, which is very dreadful to the world, I was scaring the forest sages. One day, a great sage by the name Stula Shira was collecting forest produce for his Vedic ritual, and I scared him with this ugly form, and that made him angry. At that time, he cursed me, saying that hereafter I will permanently, or in the future, I will be having only this horrendous form, and my present bodily beauty will vanish. Then I begged him, I asked him for forgiveness, and I asked him to release me from this curse. Then he said, when Rama burns you down in an uninhabited forest on chopping away your shoulders, you will regain your own grand and auspicious form. Then he continues the story. He says, then later, I did several austerities to please grandfather Brahma, and Brahma gave me a boon of longevity. He said, I'll live for many years. So having the pride that I had a very long life, I once attacked Indra in the battle, and Indra, using his Vajrayuda, that has 100 cutting edges, he hurled it at me, and it rammed my head into my body, and that's why I have this kind of a form. Again, I begged Indra, asking him to kill me and send me to the abode of Yama, but Indra told me that the boon of Brahma will not go waste, and I will continue to live. And then Indra also told me that when Lord Ram comes and severs off your arms along with Lakshmana in a conflict, and when you were burnt after that, you can go to heaven. So Indra said this and he vanished. So he says, O Rama, if you bless me by burning my body in fire, I can help you by giving you a clue to what you must be doing next to find Sita. I will tell you about a prospective friend. You know, I will tell you a clue how you can find Sita. So Rama said, all right, I will burn you. So he brings up a dried wood and he begins to dig a large trench. And he say, okay, look, I'll do this. I will incinerate you. But you have to tell me how to find Sita. Then Kamanda says, as of now, I'm in this demoniac body. I'm not able to access my divine knowledge. I cannot identify Maitali. But when I'm burnt and I assume my original form, then I'll be able to tell you about the person who can help you find her. And who's this person who's going to help him find her is actually Sugriva. So Kabanda tells Rama that there is one person in my mind that he knows everything. He will be of great help to you, but first you must burn me so that I can give you more details. So then Rama, he makes a pyre and he incinerates Kabanda. And then Kabanda takes a very beautiful angelic form dressed in white garments and wearing beautiful garlands. And he ascends on a beautiful chariot, a heavenly chariot, and he tells Ram, there is one Vanara by the name Sugriva. He is the son of the sun god and he is waiting to take revenge on his brother Vali. Sugriva is living on Mount Rishyamukha. It's a mountain available on the fringes of the Pampa Lake. He's living there along with four other Vanaras. So Rama, he will be your associate and aid in searching Sita. So Rama, you must go meet Sugriva, make a bond of friendship with him, take your vows in front of fire. Vows of friendship, even that is taken in front of fire, just like you take vows of marriage. So he says, you go take a vow in front of fire, become his friend, and then Kabanda says, once you befriend him, everything will be solved. Then he describes the beauty of Pampa Sarovar and Rishyamukha Parvat, and then he tells him to proceed. And he also gives one more thing, one more information. He says, also, you should go and meet a woman who is living in Sage Matanga's ashram. She is waiting for you. Go and bless her. Who is this woman? It is Shabari. So he gives these two instructions and he goes away. We stop here. Sorry for continuing for 5 more minutes. Please forgive me. So we'll end here and then we'll see what happened after this. This is almost, we are in the end of Aranyakanda. Aranyakanda finishes off with Ram blessing Shabari. Okay, that story is a big story, so I won't do it today. We'll do it only that portion of the Aranyakanda in the next class. So with that, Aranyakanda is over. Next, after that, we will go to Kishkindha Kanda. Once Ramchandra goes to Kishkindha to meet the Vanara. Okay, thank you all so much. Thank you for your patient listening. Hare Krishna. If you have any questions, comments, corrections, please go ahead.
Hare Krishna, Devilasmi Mataji. Thank you for taking us and letting us be with Ramachandra as he was going through his journey for searching for Sita. It was fantastic. No comment except I wish it wouldn't have ended. Hare Krishna.
Thank you so much, Padeshwari Lakshmi Mataji. So happy to have you on the call and encourage all of us. Hare Krishna.
Krishna.
Hare Krishna, Preeti Vilasini Mataji. This is Gorangi.
Hare Krishna. Oh, I didn't send you a reminder. I'm sorry.
No, that's okay. I know last Monday you did remind, but
yeah.
Tuesday, no, right?
Yeah. After you attended, this is the next class that I'm doing. Uh-huh. After I sent you the email, I sent you the recording, right? After that,
yes.
This is the only class. Yeah, yeah.
Oh, okay, good.
Yeah.
And if I can beg you for this one, too.
Yeah, of course, definitely I'll do it, Mataji. Definitely
Thank
I'll
you.
Send it to you.
Thank you so much. I was just curious about Jatayu. I came like a couple minutes late this morning, but so I don't know how in-depth you went into the story why Jatayu and Dasharatha were such good friends, so much so that Ram and Sita saw him as father.
Actually, Valmiki Ramayana, there's not much details. It just says that the first time Ram meets Jatayu, he introduces himself, Jatayu introduces himself as the close friend of Dasharatha. And he just says this to Ram that he's been knowing Dasharatha for many years, and they will he will protect Sita, and he will protect Ram and Lakshman when they are in need. So that is all I'm aware of, but I'm not able to find anything more. Maybe other experts on Ramayana can add if they know any story of Jatayu and Dasharatha being together and exchanging some nice time together. I'm not sure, Mataji. If someone wants to add, they can add.
Yeah. actually, and then just one other thing. I was a little confused when you were describing the good fortune of Jatayu to, he was, although he was a vulture, he got this, good fortune from Ram, to be liberated by Ram. And in that context, you were saying about, how the worst thing is for someone to kill a brahmana, right?
Mm-hmm.
And so I lost the connection between that and Jatayu.
Oh, yeah. So basically, there are two things. One is, different kinds, when we discuss about different kinds of sins, killing a brahmana, killing a fetus in the womb, there are many kinds of sins, of which some sins are considered as extremely bad, killing a cow. So these sins, they say that you have to suffer birth after birth after birth, it's very, very heavy sin. So killing a brahmana is called as a brahmahatti. A person who has killed a brahmana acquires a sin known as the brahmahatti dosha. That means he has killed a brahmin, such a big sin, so he's suffering. So not only is killing a brahmin a sin, but also being killed by a brahmana means you're very sinful. Why? Because a brahmana by nature wouldn't kill anyone like that, right? Kill someone. That means you have really been so bad that a brahmin is killing you.
Uh-huh.
So technically, if you see, Jatayu is agrahatya. That means one who is being killed by a brahmin. But Ravana was no good brahmin. He was a demon, right?
Mm-hmm.
So just by rules of Shastra, you see, he's an agrahatya, but not that it's very important is what I wanted to say, because Ravana was no good brahmin. But in spite of it, though, you one person may see it as a disqualification just based on a particular rule of Shastra, it had no impact on Jatayu's liberation.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, because the most important thing is that your devotion.
Yeah, and that surrender he had in the last moment. Yeah. Yes, Mataji.
Yeah, and that's also, I'm sorry, but that also reminds me of, I was so shocked to hear that, the river Godavari.
She never answered.
I mean, but she's so exalted for her devotion.
Yeah, she's so exalted for her
So, it was like a, I was just, that's why I was so shocked. I don't know if there's any explanation for how a person who's so exalted for devotion would not, give Ram.
That's true. Even when we chant our mantra for purification, we call out for Godavari also. This is actually the Sri Vaishnava Acharyas, they have some kind of explanation for this, which I have to look up and then tell, but mm-hmm. I've not heard a clear, understand that and give a clear explanation. Maybe in the next class I can do a little more work on it and let you know of how Godavari regained her purity. She had lost her purity intermittently because she failed to tell Ram. This is what I've heard. But she regains her purity. But there's a story, but I don't know.
Mm-hmm.
I have to find out.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
I'll find out, Mataji.
Losing purity, I wonder how that manifested.
Because she failed to serve Ram, intermittently she is said to have lost her purity. I'm not sure how it manifests. Yeah, you're right.
Oh, yeah.
Even I don't know. Yeah.
Okay.
But I can work, I can find out, Mataji.
I don't want to put extra thing on you. I was just curious,
yeah.
Don't worry about it.
Yeah.
Don't worry about it.
And also, I was also trying to see if any of our Acharyas, like, you know, the 2-3 people I'm hearing from, Bhakti Charmaraj, Shadanath Maharaj, if none of them spoke particularly about this point in detail about how she lost her purity and how she regained it, so I couldn't further add it in today's class, but I'm sure there should be some explanations on this.
Thank you so very much.
Thank you, Mataji.
Mataji, thank you so much.
Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna.
Priti Vilasini, Dandwat, Jai Jai Shri Radhe, all good to Prabhupada and Gurudev. Such a wonderful class. We feel that we are entering, we are not qualified for anything, Mataji, but we are entering in Lila and we just see what is going on, Mataji. Thank you very much for such a wonderful class.
Thank you so much. Thank you so much, Vaishali Mataji.
Hare Krishna. Thank you so much, Mataji, for such a wonderful class.
Hare Krishna, Pavitra Madhavi Mataji. Dandavat, please accept my humble obeisances. Thank you so much for joining.
Thank you so much, Mataji. You always encourage and you are inspiration because of your Nectarian classes. I always try to join and it inspires me a lot. Thank you so much, Mataji.
Thank you so much, Mataji. Thanks for kind words. Thank you.
Hare Krishna, Priti Vilasini Mataji.
Kaurmoda ki Mataji, Dandavat.
Pranam, Dandavat. I read very, very many long ago the Valmiki Ramayana. I don't remember much. I don't remember much, but some of the description that I don't remember that I read in there. So I may have forgotten, you know, it's not that my memory is not perfect. But it's very new to me. Ram is, you know, asking all the living entities, have you seen Sita? Like Radharani was asking, have you seen Krishna? To all the creepers and like that. And the Jamuna and all the living entities. It's wonderful description. Very nice. Thank you.
Thank you, Mataji. Thank you so much.
Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna.
Sweet.
Hare Krishna, Mataji. Dhanavas Pranam. It was a wonderful class, Mataji.
Hare Krishna. Rupavati, Mataji, right?
Yes, Mataji.
Mataji,
I have a question.
Yes, tell me, Mataji.
So, Jatayu was age of Dashrath, and what was Ravana's age at this time?
Mm-hmm. It just says he was a youth. I don't know. He had a youthful body, is what is mentioned. I am not sure of the age, Mataji. But surely less than Jatayu, for sure. Maybe not 60,000 years, maybe younger than that.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay,
that's a good question also.
Thank you, Mataji.
Thank you, Mataji.
I look forward to your class.
Oh, thank you so much, Mataji. Yeah, and very nice questions, actually. It really makes me think. Yeah, I'll definitely look up these questions. Thank you, Mataji. Anyone else has any questions or comments or answers, additions? Okay, so then we can end the class. Vancha kalpatarubhyascha kripa sindhubhyascha patitanam pavanebhyo vaishnavebhyo namo namaha. Ananta koti vaishnavrindaki jai namacharya shri haridas thakur ki jai. Prem sikho jai shri krishna chaitanya prabhu nityananda shri advaita kadadara shri vasadi gaur bhakta vrinda shri prabhupad ki jai valmiki ramayana ki jai. All glories to the assembled devotees. Hare Krishna.
Thank you. Lakshmi Mataji ki jai. Hare Krishna.
Lakshmi Lakshmi ki jai. Thank you very much, Mataji.
Hare Krishna.
Thank you so much, Mataji. Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna.